Social problem solving is essential to life. It's essential to everything that we hold valuable. Why? Social problem solving. When I think about social problem solving, I think about the social innovators and the people who are trying to figure out how to bring our communities together. I think about the people who are trying to make a difference for the issues of crime, poverty, issues of environmental degradation. I think a few minutes ago, some of you got a chance to see one of my very favorite TED Talks by Majora Carter, where she tries to talk about all the things about greening the ghetto, right? Where do these folks come from? Where do the Majora Carters in the world come from? And how can we get more of them, right? Because some of you, just like me, you grew up not too far from here, and you know we got lots of issues in the community. So what I want to take some time to talk to you about is about some of my travels and some of the things that I've done away from this place, and then relate it back to some of the things we're doing right here in Newark, New Jersey, in the state of New Jersey, that relate to it. So what are those things? Well, I said I get around. I get around to go different places because of the things that I do as a professor. I get a chance to travel. If you know me, you know I love to travel. And so I get a chance to go to Shanghai or Rio or Lagos, Nigeria. I take it. I just saw somebody invited me to Jamaica. I'm going. Reason I go is because of the research that I do. And part of the research that I do has to do with who are these social problem solvers. So when I go to Shanghai or go to Melbourne or most recently, you know, when I've gone to Johannesburg, I try to find all of the people who are in this camp of social problem solvers. So when I was in Johannesburg, I got a chance to meet the man you see on the screen named Manla Mentor. Manla Mentor is an Ashoka Fellow. Some of you know Ashoka. Ashoka is an organization that promotes social entrepreneurship, and if they find people who are making these kinds of substantial changes in their communities all around the world. Manla Mentor is known for something called the Soweto Mountain of Hope. Turns out that it wasn't a mountain of hope when it started. If you know the history of South Africa, you know that there's a history of apartheid. And in Soweto, which was one of the townships where many of the civil rights were being fought for in South Africa, there was a place that became the dumping ground. And this dumping ground became an eyesore, it became a health hazard, it became all the things you could think of that a dump would be, right? Well, where everybody else saw a dump, Manla Mentor saw opportunities. He saw an opportunity to reuse some of the materials that were in there. He saw opportunities to use it as a community building exercise to change what was there. In fact, this was at the height of the HIV/AIDS epidemic in South Africa. And what he ended up doing was figuring out ways to make this mountain of trash a mountain of hope by providing people opportunities to build monuments out of reused materials to be monuments to their loved ones. And so if you go there today, you'll see a place that's completely transformed. In the midst of that transformation, he also did community building, youth development, and thought about all the innovative ways he could impact his community. Where do we find the Manla Mentors for Newark? Well, I started asking myself that question. I said, well, let me come a little bit closer to home. Let me go to the United States of America and see if I can find people who are doing these kinds of things in their own communities. So I went to New Orleans. I went to Chicago. I met the people you see on the screen, Craig Cuccia from Cafe Reconcile. I met Brenda Palms Barber from Sweet Beginnings. And these folks were doing things in urban communities that I thought was fantastic. In New Orleans, there's a restaurant that's also a training program, that's also youth development. All these things at the same time, and it's a sustainable model. In the area of Chicago, on the west side, you have a place that's called the North Lawndale Employment Network, and they were training people for different jobs. Problem was, the jobs they were training them for didn't exist. They said, guess what? We need to not only train people for jobs, we got to create jobs too. And through a couple of things that happened in rapid succession back in the late 2000s, they ended up at a point where they created a new company that was underneath of the nonprofit organization that they'd already formed. A fully owned for-profit company that had social objectives. The social objectives in this case was creating jobs for ex-offenders. because as you know just as well as I do, they're the hardest people to get jobs for. So they said, we'll create the jobs. And you see on the screen some honey and some bath products that they have created and they sell around the country, in Whole Foods, in the airports, and all these different places. Another interesting sustainable model for creating community change. And of course, my next question was, well, how can we understand this better? So, you know, several articles, three books later, conferences, grants, and all those kind of things. I think I know a little bit about social entrepreneurship. And now, the big test. Can we do something about that here in New Jersey? You know, New Jersey is a special case, right? Because we got New York on one side, we got Philadelphia on the other side. Sometimes we get lost in the middle. So I got people who are interested in these kind of things going to those cities. And I say, just like our football team, I got to keep the talent at home. How do we create that talent? What do we do? Well, we thought about that. I say we because actually some of the people in this room were part of the efforts that we did to try to raise the profile of social entrepreneurship, social innovation, using entrepreneurship to affect social change. And we said, what can we do in New Jersey? Let's start off with some big activities. So we had three New Jersey social entrepreneurship summits. Some of you were there. And we brought speakers in. I brought in Craig. I brought in Brenda. Brought some other folks in. And we had them come and talk to the change makers, the nonprofit leaders, the people who were thinking about this stuff like you. And we said, this is now your challenge. What are you going to do in this area? Along the way, we created something called the New Jersey Social Innovation Institute. We unveiled it here in Newark back in October of 2011. That institute is a training program. We put out the call. We said, who out there has some innovative ideas about changing the community? We got 50 applications. We selected 15 groups. And we said, all right, you won part of this application process. But what we really want to do is bring you and a teammate or teammates into our training program where we're going to connect you with these ideas. And so on the screen, you see 15 different names, 15 different groups, 15 different teams of people who took up the challenge to say, I'm going to make changes in my community. But we're not going to do it in the traditional way. We're going to use the engine, the toolkit of entrepreneurship to do it. I don't care if it's nonprofit, for-profit, benefits corporation, or whatever the form of organization is going to be. But what they figured out was that they're going to use the entrepreneurial engine to make social change. And so those 15 people went through the training. You see them up on the screen. A number of them focusing on what was happening right here in Newark, around prison reentry, around parenting, around issues related to people trying to get jobs who are it's very difficult for them to get jobs. We put them through a rigorous process where at the end they actually pitched to a panel of investors to say, this is what we're working on. Here's our business plan. Tell us what you think. And when we come out the other end of this at 18 months, we've already gone through the 18 months, what I've already found out is that these folks need not just the support through that program, but we need to give them even more support as they start to launch these ventures. That's something I knew in a theoretical way before, but now I know it in a very personal way. Because as we work with these 15, we found out a few things. Because, of course, since I'm a professor, we had to study the people who were going through the program. And part of the study was to compare the folks who were in the program with people who weren't in the program. To compare this set of social entrepreneurs with some entrepreneurs outside the country, in Australia. We're going through some of that research right now. In fact, Andrew Gurmack from the School of Social Work and I just have released a paper that looks at the motivations of these, what we call, nascent social entrepreneurs. So what's the punchline here? Punchline is I've definitely learned three things in doing this. I want to share those three things with you. Then I want to give you 3 points for all the would-be social entrepreneurs out here. All right? First of the 3 points, you got to find people who are passionate about their work, and you got to support them. Now, you might think that's the easy part, right? But passion is one thing. Some people get really excited about things. But I want to combine that with you got to have a knowledge base for what you're talking about. You can be very passionate. Watch American Idol about singing and not be able to sing. So what I'm saying is that we gotta identify these folks and then support them. Second thing I'll say is that training matters. Well, we found that out by comparing the people who were in the program to the people who weren't in the program. Yeah, that kind of makes sense, right? I didn't realize how much it mattered. I can compare the group that did not do anything, any kind of training with the group that did, and you can see a vast difference in terms of the number of activities towards their goal at the end. I think the networking aspect is really important as well. And this is the third thing we found out, that it's not just about having networking abilities, because that's important, but it's having access to the right people. I know there are some people in this room right now that have great ideas, but until I connect you to the right people to help you foster that idea, hatch it into something that's going to be potentially make an impact, there can be a lot of frustration. Can be a lot of roadblocks that are hit. And so as I close this out, my advice to the folks who are thinking about this, who are thinking about how do I change my community, how do I make a difference using a little entrepreneurship in the mix? Number one, don't just be passionate about it. Develop a knowledge base. Get the training that you need. That's the second thing. And thirdly, tap into networks of people who are doing the same kind of thing you want to do. This event's one of those networks. Forward Ever Sustainable Business is one of those networks. There's other networks, like our New Jersey Social Entrepreneurship Network. And maybe there are others that are important to the issues that are important to you. I say you join them and you use those as stepping stones towards your goal. Seems simple, right? But I'll know this. I know this from our experience now, that you got to have people who are around you who can support you through it. And so I know that there are some of those folks in here right now. And I'm here to tell you that if you're going to use entrepreneurship as your vehicle for social change, I'm here for you. And I'm here to cheer you on and to help you make it happen. And that is why social problem solving is so essential to everything that we do in life. You can't change a city without social problem solvers. And if you want to do it with entrepreneurship, I'm the guy for you. So I thank you for your attention. I hope there's some folks out there going to take me up on that challenge. And if you do, you know how to find me right here at Rutgers Business School. Thank you.